غرباء 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 غرباء.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، أما بعد. There are a lot of issues that we want to deal with concerning this particular topic, the appearance of the Muslim, and the two issues that I was requested to speak about in that regard. It's the issue of the lihya and al-isbal, someone wearing their garment below their ankle bone. In regards to the issue of al-isbal, I'm not even going to deal with that, because to do justice to the first topic of the lihya requires quite a bit of time. We're going to scan over the issue, but we will deal with it in some detail, but the detail that we're dealing with it in right now no way gives it the justice that it deserves. And still, we want to deal with these different angles. There are angles concerning our aqidah, and there are angles concerning the fiqh of al-Islam, the fiqh of ikhtilaf, how do we differ amongst ourselves, and there are some angles concerning at-tarbiyah, So first thing we want to mention is that the appearance of the Muslim is important. It's not acceptable for a person to say, al-Iman is in my heart. I don't have to do this and I don't have to do that in terms of my outer appearance, because al-Iman is in my heart. The Prophet told us, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, inna fil jasadi mudghatan idha saluhat salah al-jasadu kulluhu wa idha fasadat فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ. Verily, inside of the body there is a morsel of flesh. If that morsel of flesh is wholesome, then the rest of the body is going to be wholesome. And if that morsel of flesh is not wholesome, is no good, it's corrupt, has fasad connected to it, then the rest of the body is going to also be corrupt. And he said that that morsel of flesh is the heart, which is within the person's body. It's on the inside, where his iman is, where his belief in Allah Azza wa Jal is. When he has the correct iman, or she has the correct iman, it manifests itself on the person's limbs. So al-iman with Ahl al-Sunnah consists of three things. Consists of your statement, la ilaha illallah, your belief in Allah. It consists on your limbs working by that declaration, and it consists of you having that issue being believed in inside of your heart. So it is important. Or why would Allah Azza wa Jal tell the Muslim woman to dress a particular way? And why would Allah Azza wa Jal make it haram for the Muslim man to dress in certain ways? There's certain things we can't wear and certain things that we're allowed to wear. But that's a different issue altogether. We just want to touch that very briefly, because some people, they say, al-Iman is in my heart, so I don't have to. I can wear what I want to wear. I can do what I want to do. And that's not the case. If the lady is not wearing hijab, or if her hijab is not correct, then there's something wrong with that Iman. If a man is not staying away from wearing what Allah Ta'ala or his Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has prohibited us from, and there are many issues, then there's something wrong with that person's Iman. Concerning this issue of the beard. The beard is an issue that the ulama of Islam do have some ikhtilaf concerning it. It is an issue that does have some ikhtilaf. The vast majority of ulama of Islam are of the opinion that it is not permissible for a man to do anything with his beard, to touch it, to trim it, to do anything, whether it is shaving it or cutting it all off, whether he does it before making Hajj or Umrah. They are of the opinion that you should leave it alone altogether. And that's the vast majority of the ulama of al-Islam. And then there are some scholars who take the other position, and we're going to come to that inshallah. Those scholars who say that it's not permissible to touch your beard at all, they have the strongest proofs, and they also have the majority of the proofs. I don't have the time to deal with all of the proofs, but we want to deal with a few of them. And then we want to deal with some of the proofs that the other side have, inshallah. But I want to make it very clear here that my position and my opinion is that the beard of the man, the lihya of the man, it is wajib for him to keep his beard. It is wajib for him to keep his beard, and it's not permissible for him to touch his beard at all. But we're going to come to that, inshallah. How do we deal effectively and practically with one another in this regard? From those ulama who said that it was not permissible for the Muslim man to cut his beard, to trim his beard, to shave his beard, are a number of proofs. The first proof that we want to mention is the proof that it is from the fitrah that Allah Azza wa Jalla has created men upon. The beard is from the fitrah. Many times they translate the fitrah as the natural disposition that Allah has created human beings upon. He created everyone to say La ilaha illallah. Until someone comes and corrupts his fitrah, he's going to say La ilaha illallah. If he's in an environment that is in contradiction to La ilaha illallah, it changes. Mother, his father, his environment, other than that. The beard is from the fitrah. We know that from the authentic hadith that's in Sahih Muslim. Sahih Muslim, on the authority of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. She said that the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ashrum min al-fitra. 10 things are from the fitra. Qassu sharib wa ifa' al-liha. She said that the 10 things that are from the Prophet said that the 10 things that are from the fitra is for a man to trim his mustache and for him to also leave his beard. To leave his beard. And she went on to mention in this hadith 8 other issues. 5 of them are in your head and 5 of them are in the other parts of your body. 5 are in your head and the other 5 are in your body. So the fact that Allah Azza wa Jalla's Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam described it as the fitrah is an indication that it shouldn't be changed. The fitrah, the definition of it, there is a book in Al-Islam that every student of knowledge, you know Arabic, you have to have this book to be able to refer back to this book in order to comprehend some of the difficult words that come in the authentic sunnah. What did the Prophet mean, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said the fitrah? The ulama have different interpretations. One of the scholars of Al-Islam that you all know is Al-Imam As-Suyuti. Al-Imam As-Suyuti said that the best definition of the fitrah that he knows about is the fitrah is the sunnah al-qadima allati kanu alayha anbiya'ullah. He said that the fitrah is the old sunnah that the prophets of Allah were upon. That's the meaning of the fitrah. The tawheed of the prophets, the ibadah of the prophets, the dawah of the prophets, the jihad of the prophets, doing good unto others, and so forth and so on. That's the fitrah of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The book that I wanted to bring your attention to is the book that is called An-Nihaya fi Gharib al-Hadith. An-Nihaya fi Gharib al-Hadith. One of the most important books concerning the definition of the words that come in the Sunnah by Imam Ibn al-Athir. He said that the fitrah of this hadith, the fitrah that the Prophet ﷺ was talking about, was the fitrah of the prophets. The fitrah of the prophets that Allah commanded us to follow them in their way. Like the fitrah of Ibrahim. Following the fitrah of Ibrahim and the millah of Ibrahim by doing a circumcision, by slaughtering for Allah Azza wa Jal, by doing the sacrifices of Al-Hajj and so forth and so on. And we know that this is one of the meanings because Allah Ta'ala has mentioned this issue in the Quran in regards to the beard. He mentioned in Surah Taha about Musa salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi. When Musa came off of the mountain after receiving the revelation from Allah Ta'ala, he grabbed his brother Harun by his beard. Allah mentioned that in the Quran. Qala ya ibn ummi la ta'khudh bi lihyati wa la bi ra'si. Harun, after being grabbed by his beard and his head, he said to his brother Musa, "Oh brother of my mother, oh son of my mother, don't grab me by my beard and don't grab me by my head." So the ulama who gave the tafsir of that, they said it's a clear indication that Harun, the Nabi from the Anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he had a beard because this was the sunnah of the Anbiya. Another issue concerning this fitrah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was described by his companions as having a big beard. And they used different words to describe his beard. All of the descriptions that come to us about Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali, all of them describe them as having large beards, all of them. The hadith that said that Ali radiallahu anhu cut his beard is not authentic, it's not established, but instead the Khulafa al-Rashideen, all of them had beards, and that's an indication of the hadith of the Prophet as well, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, informing us to take the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashideen. Last point concerning this. is that the Arabs in the times of Jahiliyyah, they were upon this aspect of the fitrah. Their fitrah was not corrupted in this regard. The Arabs of Al-Jahiliyyah, they were not given to cutting their beards in the Arabian Peninsula. The Arabs only started cutting their beards when they were colonized by the people who cut their beards. That's when Arabs started to cut their beards. Arab people, they are a nation unto themselves. They are jinns unto themselves. They have a special position in this deen. Allah chose the Nabi to be from them. He chose the bedrock of Al-Islam geographically is from where they come from. The Kaaba, Mecca, is their place. Allah didn't choose the Quran, the last revelation, to be in their language for no reason. There's some wisdom. The Arabs have a special position. Bani Israel, they have special position. Europeans, Africans, everyone, they have their own distinct, unique characteristics. One of the Arab characteristics of the Arabs is that the Arab part of being a man in Jahiliyyah was to have a beard. Again, they did not cut their beards in their poetry. It doesn't come like that. It was something that was frowned upon if someone came and he didn't have a beard. It was a sign of maturity, a sign of manliness, and so forth and so on. As for after they got colonized, whether they're Muslims or not Muslims, that's when they started to imitate their colonizers, and Allah Ta'ala's help is sorted. The second dalil from the many proofs that the ulama use who say that it's impermissible to cut your beard is that they say that cutting the beard is changing Allah's creation. It is a form of changing Allah's creation because it's from the fitrah, and you can't do anything to your body that the religion doesn't allow you to do. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and what was collected by the Imam Bukhari and Muslim, as well as Al-Imam Ahmed and other than them, on the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said that the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْوَاشِمَاتِ وَالْمُسْتَوْشِمَاتِ وَالنَّامِسَاتِ وَالْمُتَفَلِّجَاتِ الْمُغَيِّرَاتِ لِلْخَلْقِ اللَّهِ. May Allah curse the women who put tattoos on others and the women who get tattooed. And may Allah curse the women who change and they trim their eyebrows. And may Allah curse the women who chisel and file their teeth. They are the people who have changed Allah's creation. They are the people who changed Allah's creation. Iblis, la'natullahi alayhi, he promised and he made a threat that he was going to encourage Bani Adam to change the creation of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Now if the woman in Al-Islam, she's not allowed to cut any of her hair on her eyebrows, small portion of hair, because Allah didn't allow it to be done. If she goes and she trims her eyes, that's considered to be changing Allah's creation on the strength of this particular hadith. The same issue holds true for the man's beard, which is much more in terms of its sheer amount than what is on her eyes. So those ulama, they said cutting the beard is from changing Allah Ta'ala's creation, and that's something that's not permissible because our bodies are trust that Allah has given us. It's an amana. You have to render the amana back to Allah Azza wa Jalla when you die in the way that you received it. Don't cut anything on it and don't make an i'tida. Don't transgress on your body. You can't get implants. You can't add on to yourself hair. You can't get an operation to chisel your nose and to change your nose. You can't make your cheeks smaller or larger, your lips smaller or larger. It's not permissible in the deen because it's an indication that the person is not satisfied or happy with the way Allah has created them. There was a man during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was opposite of being bow-legged. The people with their legs are like the bow. They go out like that. This man was not knee. His knees came in, went in like that. He wore a long thobe and his thobe was dragging on the earth. The Prophet said, why are you wearing your clothes that long? The man said, Ya Rasulullah, I'm wearing my clothes like this because I want to hide the way that Allah has created my legs. I don't want people to laugh at me. The Prophet told the man, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Inna Allah Ta'ala qad ahsana kulla shay'in khalaqa. Allah has perfected everything that he created. However you are, however I am, that's what Allah chose in terms of our physical stature. If you're a short person, a tall person, naturally thin, naturally fat, or not fat, I think that's politically incorrect. You're a heavy person. Naturally, you're like that. Now, we're not talking about the one who's a glut and he overeats. We're not talking about the one who suffers from their anorexia because they don't eat. We're talking about naturally. Your ears are large, your nose is large, you have a growth on your hand, your color is like this. These are not issues that Muslims have a problem with. Allah is Al-Khaliq, and everything that he created it and fashioned it in the best proportion. And it's not permissible to change any of that, except you have the dalil. You cannot cut anything off of your body, except that there is some dalil. So the man is allowed to shed his blood by doing the circumcision. Normally that skin is not allowed to be touched and that blood is not allowed to be spilled, but the deen allowed it. The hair that's under your arms, normally it wouldn't be allowed to be taken off, but the deen allowed it. The mustache, normally it is not your right to cut it off, but Allah Azza wa Jal, on the lisan of his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he has allowed it. So the point is, and the principle is, no one can do anything about changing their body that the deen didn't allow. If he does something other than what the deen allowed, then he is mu'tadi. He is exceeding the limits. He is going beyond the boundaries that have been set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the dalil that they use is that it is resembling the non-Muslims. Again, because of the many ahadith that established this is something that we should do, it is something that is in resemblance to the non-Muslims. And that's impermissible. Unless it's a thing that al-Islam allowed. Now Muslims wear jeans. Al-Islam didn't say it's haram for us to wear jeans. Now Muslims, they wear shirts and suits. Al-Islam didn't say we can't wear shirts and suits. But those clothes that are peculiar to non-Muslims and the ways of the non-Muslims that are peculiar to them, it's not permissible for us to resemble them in those things. Due to the hadith, من تشبه بقوم فهو منهم. Anyone who resembles a people, then he is from those people. So the lady who puts on the suit like the nun, and you can identify the nun suit because it's special and it's peculiar to the nun. The Muslim woman, she can't look like that. The priest in the church, the vicar in the church, the Muslim man is not allowed to wear that collar that those people wear because it is a collar that is specific to them. The Muslim who becomes, the person who was a Hindu, he becomes a Muslim. She or he used to put that red thing on their heads. You can't put that on your head anymore because that is an identifying mark for shirk and the people of shirk. They are known by those things. As for the issues that no one's known for, they wear these sandals, you can wear these sandals. No one can come now and say Adidas, the sports outfit. You can't wear Adidas because non-Muslims wear Adidas. There's no dalil for that. So some people make things difficult on themselves and they make difficulties on the community as well. In regards to the beard, there are a number of hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said different words showing the importance of this. He said to the companions, Khalifu al-mushrikeen, be different from the mushrikeen. Leave your mustache and leave, trim your mustache and leave your beard. Khalifu Ahl al-Kitab, be different from the Ahl al-Kitab. Shave your mustaches, trim your mustaches and leave your beard. He said, Khalifu al-Majus, be different from the Magians. Trim your mustache and leave your beards. So he was telling the companions, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in, wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the non-Muslims, whether they were Ahl al-Kitab, whether they were the Majus, whether they were the Mushrikeen of Mecca, as we mentioned, Kuffar of Quraysh used to have their beards. But although they used to have their beards, they used to grow their mustaches as well. So he said, be different from them. Leave the beard, but trim the mustache. Be different from Ahl al-Kitab and be different from the Majus, who sometimes they had beards and sometimes they didn't. The Magians, the Majus, they didn't have beards. The Magians, the Majus, they used to do their mustaches and they used to roll them up like that, like the British people do. The guys who smoke the pipes. He has the mustache that goes like that. When one of the emissaries came from Persia, he was a messenger for the man who sent them, the king, the leader of Persia. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, upon seeing the man, and he had a big mustache and it went up like that, he said, who ordered you? Who commanded you to leave your mustache like that? The man said, my Lord did, meaning his leader. My Lord, my Rabb, he told me to do it. Prophet told him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and my Lord commanded me to trim the mustache. So the point here is, the ulama of al-Islam, they said if a person were to trim his beard, touch his beard, cut his beard, he's resembling the non-Muslims because they are the individuals who are given to making these changes in their lihya. Another point concerning this, ikhwani, is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in these many hadith commanded the people to leave their beards, he used many different words. Not only did he say be different from the Ahlul Kitab, be different from the Majus, and be different from the Mushrikeen, he said in using different verbs, arhu al-liha. He used the word leave your beards by using a particular word. Waffiru al-liha, used another word. He said in another hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a'fu al-liha. He used about 5 or 6 different words showing the emphasis and the importance of the issue, similar to the sutra. You know that a thing is wajib in al-Islam or is impermissible not to do it when you find a lot of variations coming talking about that thing. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanding the people to pray with a sutra. Like him prohibiting the people from praying without a sutra. Like him sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself never ever ever abandoning the sutra. That variety is a variety of a ta'kid. It shows the emphasis of this particular issue. So I want to say to you before moving on to the next point, inshallah, is that you don't find a single hadith in the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that goes against his command to leave the beard. Not a single hadith. You don't find a single authentic hadith where he saw someone and their beard was cut and he remained silent. Or where he said to someone, cut your beard or shave your beard or fix up your beard. You don't see him himself cutting his beard. Because as we mentioned a number of times, the sunnah is what he said. The sunnah is what he did. And the sunnah was what was done in his presence. And he gave his tacit approval and he would remain silent. You have all of these ahadith in Bukhari and Muslim and other than Bukhari and Muslim with him telling the people, be different from the Yahud and the Nasara, be different from the Mushrikeen, be different from the Majus. And he used different verbs in order to command the people to leave the beard. And you don't find a single hadith where that was contradicted by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Not one. So the principle in regards to the beard, the hadith, pay attention to this. The principle is with the ulama of al-hadith and the ulama of al-fiqh, the principle is there's not a single authentic hadith, not one in the dunya, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to someone, cut your beard, or someone cut their beard or shaved it, or was shaven in his presence and he saw it. So anytime you read or you hear someone uses as a dalil the hadith in which the Prophet says sallallahu alayhi wasallam to the man, go and fix your beard up and shave it, is fabricated. It's either fabricated or extremely weak or weak. Not a single one is authentic. Now there are other dalil, other proofs, but we want to get to some other issues. There are other proofs like the one who touches his beard, he's resembling the women, because Allah Ta'ala has not created women with beards for the most part. The woman that has a beard, she's breaking the norm. That's not the norm. That's not the norm. And our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, when she used to want to swear, you say, Wallahi, Tallahi, Billahi, Wa Izzatillah, Wa Rabbil Kaaba, Wa Rabb Muhammadin, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You can swear as long as you swear by Allah or a characteristic of Allah. When our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, Umm Abdullah al-Humaira bintu Saddiq radiallahu anhuma, when she used to want to swear, she used to use different methods. One of the methods she used to say was, وَالَّذِي زَيِّنَ الرِّجَالِ بِالْلِحَى, I swear by the one who beautify the men by their beards. I swear by the one who beautify the man with his by the beard. That was one of the methods that she used to swear by Allah Azza wa Jal, because she clearly understood, as we understand, Allah Azza wa Jal, he has created the beard, and it is for men. It's for men. So the man who shaves his beard, he's resembling the women. He's resembling the women. And it's not permissible for the men to resemble the women, as the Prophet ﷺ has cursed both of those parties. He cursed the men who resemble women and the women who resemble men. It's not permissible for either group to resemble the other group. Now, we want to deal with the other side of the coin. The other side of the coin. Many brothers don't know, so they get upset. And I say we have to be in the middle here. And we have to be on the way of the companions and the ulama of fiqh and the ulama of al-hadith in this regard. People who see the permissibility of trimming the beard or cutting the beard, they do have some proofs. Although they are shubahat, they do have some proofs. And it is an issue of ikhtilaf. So we have to stay in the middle. One extreme is the extreme of the person who makes wala wal bara on this issue. If a person cuts his beard or shaves his beard, you look down upon him and you want to boycott him and kick him off of the sunnah. And it's an indication that he doesn't have any deen. It was like that to some of the ulama. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullahu ta'ala, would not allow a man who cut his beard to make the shahada in his court, because that individual is showing that he is an open sinner. That was his opinion in regards to this particular issue. But if you see a person and he studied the issue, and based upon conviction, he took the position that it's permissible to shave his beard, who are you and who am I to hate him for that issue? I believe he should not cut his beard and he shouldn't touch his beard. But if he took the issue and he studied it based upon what I'm about to tell you right now, and he did it with conviction, not just because he heard it there and it's something he just wants to take advantage of, he believes this that way, then who are you and who am I to be upset with him? Especially in light of the fact he has people like this who preceded him. So there are companions and there are major tabi'een who either cut their beards themselves, shaved it, not cut it all off, they shaved it, or they told people to shave it, or they gave the fatwa that it's okay to shave it, or they explained ayat of the Quran and words in the Quran to mean the permissibility of shaving the beard. He understood that that ayat in Surah Al-Hajj meant that it's permissible for you to shave your beard. And they're from the companions. And they're from the major tabi'een. Again, there are companions. And there are major tabi'een, personalities in this deen, from the four imams even, individuals who were of the opinion that it was permissible to shave the beard, to trim it up. They themselves did it. They gave the fatwa to do it, some of them. Some of them explained ayahs of the Quran as being an indication that it's permissible. When they were asked, they said, no problem. And they did this in two ways. One way was open-ended. They just said, it's okay, no problem. They didn't indicate how much you can take and where you can take from and when you can take it. And then the other group, when they said it was okay, they did it and it was muqayyid. It was restricted. They say you can only take so much and you can only do it at a particular time. But you have both of those positions being represented. Who are they? Who are those people, and what are some of the issues that happened? For those people who said that it was okay, open-ended, you can take how much you want it, whenever you want it. From them, at the top of the list is Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu. He gave the explanation of the word in the Quran in Surah Al-Hajj, At-Tafith. At-Tafith is from the manasik of Al-Hajj. He said the meaning of At-Tafith to the Arabs, the meaning of this word that Allah mentioned in the Quran, is for a person to slaughter, for him to throw at the jamarat or to throw something. It means also for him to shave and to trim his nails, to trim his mustache, and to trim his beard. He didn't give any specific time. He said the meaning of that word that is mentioned in the Quran to the Arabs, at tafith, it means a person can slaughter, it means to slaughter, it means to throw, it means to shave your, trim your nails, your mustache, and your beard. And that's an authentic hadith, an explanation of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. As for the tabi'een, there are quite a few, and they're all very famous. Al-Imam Ta'us, he used to trim his beard. He used to take from his beard. This man is a tremendous man in al-Islam. Similar to him is from the tabi'een, Al-Imam Al-Qasim. He used to take from his beard. He used to trim his beard openly. They asked Al-Imam Al-Hasan Al-Basri, what is the ruling of taking from the beard? He said, La ba's, it's no problem. You're not at fault. Authentic. Sahih. They asked Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Sirin, from the ulama of the Salaf, from those tabi'een who we take our religion from, what is the ruling concerning shaving the beard, touching the beard, trimming up the beard? He said, no problem. No problem. From the tabi'een, Muhammad ibn Ka'b al-Qurtubi, from the major ulama from the tabi'een, he gave the ruling and the tafsir that is permissible for a man to take from his beard. So when a person comes and he says, based upon studying what they said and what they did, I really believe that it's permissible to do this. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he did it. He said that it was okay. Rather, he said it was okay. He gave the explanation of that word. In addition to that, those scholars from the companions and from the tabi'een who said that it was permissible to take from your beard, restricted. You can only take from certain parts of the beard. You can only take from the beard at certain times, like when you're making Hajj or Umrah. Nonetheless, you can do it, but it's restricted. Some of them said unrestricted. You can take from wherever you want, how much you want. Just don't take it all off. And you can do it whenever you want. The other group said, you can take from it, but you only can take from certain parts, from the side. You can only take from it doing Hajj or Umrah. From those individuals is Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, and what was collected by Imam al-Bukhari. Abdullah ibn Umar was known for his tenacity in his tamassuk of the sunnah. He was a person who was known for following the Prophet's sunnah and loving the sunnah. His son sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his son radiallahu anhu, was sitting plucking some rocks, plucking the rocks. Abdullah ibn Umar went by and told his son, stop plucking those rocks. I heard the Prophet say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when you pluck rocks, all it's going to do is knock someone's eye out, break his tooth, and it doesn't help you in jihad. It's not an art you can learn to get the enemy with. It can't help you. So don't do it. It's going to knock someone's eye out accidentally, inadvertently, or you're going to break someone's tooth. And it doesn't help you in jihad. He left. He came back. His son was still plucking the rocks. He said to his son, I told you the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you're still doing it after I told you, wallahi, I won't talk to you anymore. And he boycotted his son. That's one son. His other son was married. He had jealousy for his wife. His other son said to his wife, you can't go to the masjid because I don't want other men seeing you and I don't want you outside of this house. She said, but what about what the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Don't stop the women from going to the homes of Allah. He said, I'm telling you, don't go out of this house. When his wife met up with the boy's father, Abdullah ibn Umar, she said, your son is preventing me from going to the masjid. And I told him the hadith. Abdullah ibn Umar went to his son Bilal. He said, do you not know that the Prophet said, La tamna'u ama Allah min masajidillah? Don't stop the women, the handmaidens, of going to the masajid of Allah. He said, yes, Abi, but there's a lot of fitna that's out there. Wallahi, I'm going to continue to stop her from going. He said, I tell you that the Prophet said something. You tell me, wallahi, you're going to go against it. He boycotted his son. And on his deathbed, when that son came to ask his father, forgive me, and the people told Ibn Umar, you're about to die, Ibn Umar. Make peace with your son. Abdullah ibn Umar said, let him in. When he came in, Abdullah ibn Umar turned over and gave him his back and died without forgiving his son. That's how Abdullah ibn Umar was on the sunnah. When he wanted to perform Hajj from Al-Madinah, he used to take his animal to the tree where he remembered Rasulullah got off of his animal, tied it up by this tree, went over there and went to the and used the bathroom, the call of nature, akramakum Allah. He did the same thing. When the news came back to his father, Umar, Umar said, stop doing this. Because the people are looking at you and they're going to think that they have to do this. Allah didn't make this your responsibility. The point of all of that, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he wasn't an ordinary companion in that he was well known, mashhur, ushtuhira. He became well known and famous for his tenacity and being mutamassik with the sunnah. And yet, whenever he wanted to perform Hajj or Umrah, he would grab his lihya with his hand, and whatever came below that hand, he would cut it off, radiallahu anhu. That's inside al-Bukhari. He only did that for Hajj and Umrah. He didn't do that outside of Hajj and Umrah. He only did that in Hajj and Umrah. So therefore, he took and he touched the lihya. From that as well is the tafsir of Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas. In Surah Al-Hajj, Surah Al-Hajj, that tells us some of the ahkam of Al-Hajj, ayat number 29. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in ayat 29 from Surah Al-Hajj, ثُمَّ لِيَقْدُوا تَفَثَهُمْ. And then let the pilgrims do the tafath. Let the pilgrims do the tafath. Abdullah ibn Abbas said Allah is commanding the people that after they come from Muzdalifah, let them do the tafath. What they have to do is they have to stone the Jamarah. They have to cut their hair off. They have to also slaughter the animal. And they have to trim their mustache and they have to shave their beard during the time of Al-Hajj. So that was the tafsir of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. From those people who used to do this, Ikhwani, was Atta ibn Abi Rabah, who was from the tremendous Tabi'een. Atta ibn Abi Rabah, he used to take from his beard. When he was questioned about it, he said, they used to leave their beards and they would let their beards grow except for Hajj and Umrah. And he said, وَكَانَ إِبْرَهِيمُ يَأْخُذُ مِنْ أَرْضْ لِحْيَتِهِ. He said, Ibrahim al-Nakhai, from the students of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he used to take from the side of his beard. So that's two people in one narration. So the scholar, the Tabi, al-Imam Atta ibn Abi Rabah, he said that they used to leave their beards, meaning the Tabi'een. They used to let their beards grow, but they would take from their beards doing Hajj and Umrah. And I saw Ibrahim al-Nakhai take from the side of his beard. And Ibrahim al-Nakhai, as I mentioned, one of the prolific premier students of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Now we come to an issue, Ikhwani, about the fiqh and how do we understand the issue that we're dealing with. And I think it's crystal clear. What do we do in our deen as Muslims when we find the companion doing something against the Quran and the Sunnah? The companion goes against what the hadith said. What do we do? What's our position? And if we know the position concerning the companion, then we should know the position of everyone else after the companion. What do we do when Al-Imam Abu Hanifa's position goes against the hadith? That should be a no-brainer and it should be very easy and simple to comprehend and understand. Believe Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, figuratively speaking, because I know some people get upset if you say that. Leave Al-Imam Abu Hanifa and they take it the wrong way. Leave that. Don't concern yourself with that issue, the companion. What do we do with Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu? The hadith said do this and he did other than that. First thing that we do is understand that the scholars have two positions in this regard. Two positions of what to do. Part of being Salafi and as Salafiyah is practicing what the companions did. The way they practiced this religion. What they understood from the Quran. What they understood from the Sunnah. How they did it. Whatever they did and comprehended and understood, we should do the same thing. We have a religious responsibility to follow them. to follow them. So the scholars took two positions. The first position is, if the companion goes against the hadith, then we leave the position of the companion and we take the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, obviously because he's the only one who's ma'asum. He's the only one who is infallible and he doesn't make a mistake. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, all of them took positions that were contrary to the correct issue. We gave a talk here in one of our Sunday classes, and the talk was about how the companions made mistakes and other companions advised them, and when they were advised, they went to the haq. That's how they were. Everyone made mistakes from amongst them, radiallahu anhum ajma'een, and every human being after them is going to make mistakes. Again, I repeat, for you to believe that any sheikh is ma'asum in the minhaj of the Salafi, if you hear someone make that statement and you're afraid to say, sheikh so-and-so is ma'asum in the minhaj, we heard that and we hear that. Some people understand that. Sheikh so-and-so is ma'asum in the minhaj. That statement is batil, and that's not from our deen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throw that statement and make it far, far away from the people who want to follow the sunnah, because that is ghulu, ghulu. The only ma'asum in this deen is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The second position is the position of the ahnaf, and it has its validity. And it is it's a beneficial position. Their position is, if the companion goes against the narration, he goes against the narration, and it's clear that he went against the narration is true, but what he's doing is the wrong thing, then you take the narration. But if the companion is the one who narrated that narration, and he went against that narration, that he is the narrator of that hadith, he said that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this or did that, he himself narrated it and he went against it and he didn't work with it, the ahnaf are of the opinion that you have to do what that companion did, because that companion must know something about that issue that maybe we don't know. He must know that that narration is abrogated. He must know that that narration is practiced at a certain time or a certain way or a certain place. That's their position. The majority of the ulama are with the first position, and the minority of the ulama are with the second position, because although the second position does make some sense, it is not the case. Allah commanded us in the Quran and the Sunnah in so many ayahs to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to follow him exclusively, unconditionally. And as Al-Imam Malik said, everyone, his statements are accepted or rejected except Rasulullah. That's it. Now in this issue of the lihya, Abdullah ibn Umar is one of the narrators of the hadith that the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, be different from the mushrikeen. Trim your mustaches and leave your beards. Abdullah ibn Umar said that. He narrated that hadith. And then he came and he cut his hadith, he cut his beard. He shaved his beard for Hajj and Umrah. So the Ahnaf say, Abdullah ibn Umar, he knew better because he's the narrator of the hadith. He knew what it meant. He knew what it entailed. He must know something that would allow him to do what he's doing. So therefore, we should practice what Abdullah ibn Umar is doing in this particular issue. What he's doing is the sunnah. What he's doing is permissible. That's rejected for a number of reasons, as I mentioned already. Number one, simply because Abdullah ibn Umar is a human being. And Allah didn't send him to be the one who would be followed exclusively. Number two, there are examples with the Ahnaf where a narrator narrated a hadith and he went against that hadith that he narrated, and they took the hadith and they didn't do what the narrator did because what he did was in conflict with the hadith. Like the authentic hadith is inside Bukhari and other than Bukhari about the Salatul Wusta. Allah told us to take care of the Salat. Don't be negligent about your salat, and to take care specifically of the middle salat. Ali ibn Abi Talib and Abdullah ibn Abbas, both of them narrated a hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the salat al-wusta, the middle prayer, is al-asr. The Prophet said that. Sahih al-Bukhari is established. Ali narrated that hadith and Abdullah ibn Abbas narrated that hadith. Later on, someone came to Ali ibn Abi Talib and asked him about the ayah. What is the middle prayer, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen? Ali said the middle prayer is Fajr. The middle prayer is Fajr. He said, how is that? How is the middle prayer Fajr? How is that? He said, because the first prayer that the Muslims prayed was Maghrib, and then Isha, and then Fajr, and then Dhuhr and Asr. So the middle prayer is Fajr. If you ask the Hanafi madhab, the middle prayer in their madhab is Al-Asr, taking the hadith, and that's correct. That's what the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So why not practice this issue here? Another example of that is our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. Aisha narrated the hadith in which she said that the Prophet made it prohibited, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for a woman to make tawaf while she's on her menses, akramakum Allah. Because tawaf is salat, but Allah allowed you to speak, so you only should say what is good. When you make tawaf around the Kaaba, you can talk about things. It's salat. So when a woman is on her hayda, she can't go around the Kaaba, just like she can't pray. Aisha narrated that hadith. One time she was making the tawaf, a lady was with her, and her menses came while she was making the tawaf. Aisha still continued, and I'll continue with her, and allowed her to go around, and she herself helped her to go around. So she allowed it. Her action went against the hadith that she narrated, but if you ask the people of the Hanafi madhab, they're going to say it's not permissible for the lady to go around the Kaaba because of the hadith that Aisha narrated, although Aisha radiallahu anha went against that hadith in this authentic incident. And there are many examples like that. Many examples, but there are 3 points that I want to make real quick. Khwani, we're going to wind this up. 3 points about this issue, about what the Ahnaf said. The first point is, it goes to show everyone is open to human error. The companions, the ulama, they open up to human error, every human being. And the fact that the Ahnaf took this position, don't misunderstand what I'm saying here. I'm not saying to you, the madhabs have no benefit. The Ahnaf, they don't know what they're doing. This is the problem with blind. I'm not telling you that. From the richness of the jurisprudence of Al-Islam is that the scholars come up with these ideas in order to help facilitate worshiping Allah correctly and doing the right thing. But when the truth comes to an individual, he has to recognize the truth for what it is, and the truth has to be more beloved to him than all else. Thirdly, it is not just the Ahnaf who have this issue. This is the same thing with other madhahib. Other madhahib have this same issue, where they come up with these principles, and the principles are contradicted in the practical applications of some of the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, again, because of the human error and the dynamics of being a human being. Some people do it because they want to play around. Some people will do it because they want to take advantage. Some people will do it because they want an easy way out. Some people do it because of ignorance. There are different variables that fit into the equation. The point is, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is what we have to practice and what we have to do. Which brings me to the last points. The last points, Ikhwani, is that concerning the lihya, the ulama of al-Islam have four positions. The first position is that it's not permissible for you to touch your beard at all, at any place, at any time. And that's the majority of the ulama of Islam. Don't touch your beard at all. And the majority of the dalil are with them, and the strongest proofs are with them, and Allah knows best. Second position, and that's the position of Al-Imam Ibn Hazm. That's the position of Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i. That's the position of Al-Imam Ahmed in the narration to him. And that is the position of Al-Imam An-Nawawi, who dealt with this issue extensively when he gave the explanation of that hadith of Aisha in Sahih Muslim. And another thing about that hadith in Sahih Muslim, 10 things are from the fitrah. That's one of the hadith that the scholars criticized Al-Imam Muslim about. Some scholars said that that hadith is da'if. Seems to be authentic, but it does have some kalami. Second position of the ulama concerning the beard of the man is that you have to leave it at all times, but you're allowed to trim it in Hajj and Umrah only. You're allowed to trim it in Hajj and Umrah only. And Al-Imam Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, he attributed this statement to Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. Shafi'i said, don't touch your beard at all. Hafidh al-Hafidh ibn Hajar said that Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was of the opinion as well that it was permissible to trim the beard for Hajj or Umrah. Third position is that it is highly recommended if a person's beard is going all over the place, is very long, extraordinarily long, and it's all over the place, it's permissible for him to trim it nicely. His beard is very long, it's not growing correctly, he's a professional, and he doesn't want to look like a monster, he doesn't want to look unprofessional. The third position is that it is permissible. If it's long, it became very long, then he can trim it and sort it out. That's the position of Al-Imam Malik. Al-Imam Malik, again, a man who was known for his tenacity and holding on to the sunnah. Fourth position is if the beard goes beyond a qabda, when you do this and you grab your beard like that, at any time it goes beyond that, you can cut it. This is as far as you have to let it go. Any time it goes beyond that, you can cut it. Those are the four positions of the imams of the sunnah with their dalil. These things have been mentioned in their books, and that's the four positions. Lastly, 2 points I want to bring to your attention. There is a statement in fiqh that says there's no inkar in the masail of ijtihad. You shouldn't be rough and tough with people about an issue that has ijtihad. This is a famous statement. لا إنكار في المسائل الاجتهادية. So we have a group of brothers now. May Allah guide us and guide them, forgive us, forgive them, who seem to want to take the easy way out about everything, and they say, it's اختلاف, so you can do it. اختلاف, so you can do it. Al-Isbal is ikhtilaf, cutting the beard, ikhtilaf. It seems to be this new approach, ikhtilaf, everything ikhtilaf. And then the statement is, there's no inkar on the issue that there's ikhtilaf. As long as it's ikhtilaf, two positions, don't be rough and tough. That statement is true if there's no dalil in the issue. There's no dalil. One sheikh, and I show you the innovation of what some people who claim the sunnah are upon doing these days. One sheikh says, this man is an innovator, and he gives his reason. Another bona fide scholar, bigger, says that same man is not an innovator. That's ijtihad from that sheikh, that's ijtihad from that sheikh. He shouldn't be rough with him, and he shouldn't be rough with him. The people who took his position shouldn't be rough with the ones who took his position, and vice versa. Because there's no ayat of the Quran and there's no hadith of the Quran that came down and established this. And for people to split over this issue is an innovation, and it's not permissible. The group, the Jam'iyya Ihya Turath, بغض النظر, without mentioning who supports them, who doesn't support them. This sheikh says that's an innovative group. This other sheikh said, no, they're not innovators. With that sheikh are some people, and with this sheikh are other shiuch who cooperate with them and so forth and so on. How in the world is it permissible for you and I to come and to hate each other over this issue? That there's no ayat of the Quran, and there's no sunnah, and there's no ijma', and the ulama themselves took varying positions. Wallahi, this is in of itself ghulu and dhulm and jahl. In this issue, there's no inkar, there's no shiddi, there's no being rough and tough in these issues, even in fiqh. There's no dalil. So you make ijtihad. Should you hit the ground when you're making tayammum twice or once? Should you go up to here or should you go up to there? He chooses that, he chooses that. Don't boycott over these issues. Don't boycott over these issues. But when there is dalil, when there is dalil, you give your position, and you can be strong on your position. You can be passionate about your position. You tell the person, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never took his from his beard. He said all of those hadith is from the fitrah. You're resembling the women, whether you mean it or you don't mean it. That's what it is. It's changing Allah's creation. It's a kabira from the kabair. And you can talk like that. But it doesn't mean, again, that you boycott based upon these issues. But the ulama took strong positions. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa didn't allow that man. Someone stole his property. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa said, prove it's your property. He brings Abdullah and Ahmed. Ahmed has a full-length beard. Abdullah doesn't have a beard. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa said, look. Abdullah can't come. Ahmed, this one, he can't say anything in this courtroom. He can't say anything as a witness because he disqualified himself. Second thing, Khwani, is that staying in the middle course in this regard is that we do have to see it as being a major sin. And the reason why the Imam Abu Hanifa took that position is the hadith, Kullu ummati ma'afa ila al-mujahireen. All of my ummah will be forgiven except those people who do the sins out in the open. Out in the open. Everyone here in the privacy of his own home, they're doing something or some things. Everyone, the privacy of their own homes. But when you come outside and you do these things, it's different. Smoking in public, drinking in public, when you cut your beard in public, you're coming in front of the community committing a big crime. So the ulama of Islam, who are of the opinion that you can't touch your beard, they used to not allow the one who didn't have a beard, he couldn't leave the people in the salat. He's not the one who can make the adhan because there's some problem in his adala, in his deen. That was their position. That was their position. But it's not permissible. Although it is a major sin being done out in the open, although that's the case, no one has the right to ostracize and to isolate people and to look down at people because he doesn't have a beard or he trimmed his beard. That's not the way to deal with it. The hadith said, "Thalathum munjiyat." Three things will save you. The very first thing he said, "Khashyatullah fi silli wal alaniya." Fearing Allah in secret and out in the open. Everyone has a responsibility to fear Allah out in the open with his beard and other than his beard. But we also have a religious responsibility when we go behind closed doors to fear Allah. So there's the person who has a beard. He has a beard. He comes out with a beard. But behind closed doors, there are other issues that are going on. Serious issues that may be bigger than the one who trimmed his beard outside. So the person can't be judgmental like that. You look at a man, he doesn't have his beard. You give him da'wah in a nice way. You make du'a for him. You explain the issue to him. If you have power over him or a position with him, you put pressure on him. But al-wala wal-bara and these issues not permissible. And these issues of ijtihad, these are the guidelines that our scholars have laid for us. I don't want anyone leaving this place thinking that I'm saying you can cut your beard. I'm of the opinion you shouldn't touch your beard at all. You shouldn't touch your beard at all. At Hajj Umrah, you want to do Hajj Umrah and you can do that qabda, you can do it inshallah because that's thabit. Abdullah ibn Abbas used to do it, radiallahu anhu. Other than that, I'm of the opinion with the majority of the scholars, but I still say we have to be balanced. And the more knowledge we get, the better we are able to deal with each other and people who don't agree with us. As for al-isbal, we'll deal with the issue of al-isbal inshallah at another time to give it its proper approach and thorough inshallah presentation, at least to the best of our ability. And Allah knows best, and He is a'la and a'lam. Yeah, I mentioned during the talk, Khwani shave, and I thought that I came back and said, and I clarified that none of them were of the opinion that you can shave your beard off completely. But in those statements where some of the tabi'een were asked about taking from the beard, and they said open-ended, unrestricted, that is no problem. If a person wanted to understand that way, he could, because there's nothing that comes to say they didn't mean that. Other than the fact, if it was something that was done, that would have been relayed to us. If it happened where someone shaved all of his beard off, we would have heard about an issue like that. Just as we heard about all of these rulings that some said yes at this time, restricted, unrestricted, and so forth and so on. So I don't understand, nor am I trying to get that message across, that shaving all of the beard off is what is permissible. But if a man wants to shave his beard down, this much, that much, that much, this much, then he could understand from this that that is something that is permissible. The other thing is, I thought to myself, these brothers gave me this topic. I didn't choose this topic. I told the brothers, I don't want those corny topics that sometimes I hear people give. I don't want a corny topic. They gave me this topic. I said, okay. I thought to myself, in presenting the topic, I don't want to run the risk of showing that shaving the beard is okay. The one who's sitting there and he doesn't leave his beard, he says, okay, mashallah, I never really knew that, so now I'm okay. No, you have to study the issue properly. Don't just sit there and say, I said, you have to study the issue properly and try to have conviction either way. And if you come to the conclusion with ikhlas, to the best of your ability, that this is what you should do or that's what you should do, based upon you're ready to meet Allah, Yawm al-Qiyamah, you know what you're doing, then that's your deen. That's what I encourage you to do. I don't encourage you to sit there and you say, oh, mashallah, a breath of fresh air. I'm in the clear now. I heard it said, Abu Usama said it. And plus, Abu Usama could be wrong. I think I'm right and I think you're wrong. But I know that I can be wrong and you can be right. I think I'm right and I think you're wrong. But I know that I could be wrong and I know it's possible that you can be right. So shaving a beard is a kabira from the kabair and it's something that's mayambali. So if you brothers have any questions or any comments, you can put them forth now for the next few minutes, inshallah. What time is that? Okay. Do you brothers have any questions, ikhwani? Tafaddal ya akhi. Shaving all of the mustache off, all of the mustache off. Al-Imam Malik, rahimahullahu ta'ala wa radiyallahu anhu anna. He used to say that a person who shaves off all of his mustache should be hit with shoes because this is the way of the non-Muslims. So the hadith said, anhaku shawarib. It says, shave the mustache. Many of the words that are being used, you understand, it means shave. But this particular word, anhaku, it could mean get rid of it. Like really shave it. But Al-Imam Malik was of the opinion that this was not a practice of the Salaf. Instead, this is the practice of the Ajam, the non-Arabs of Persia and other than Persia. And he said that the reward for the person who does that is that he should be hit with shoes. And that's his position. That's his position. But there's no ayat that says that. And there's no hadith that says that. And there's no ijma' of the companions that say that or of the ulama who say that. So this is a mas'ala. This is a mas'ala that there's no inkar, that's shadeed like that. That was his position. Radiallahu anhu. Any more questions, ikhwani? Naam, Akhi Kareem. Inshallah, your clothes should be above your ankle if you were a man. If you were a man, your clothes should be above your ankle. The opposite of not having them above your ankle is called al-isbal, al-isbal. Whether it is your ma'wiz, it's your longi, it's your thob, it's your pants, whatever it is, it should be above your ankle. And it's from a major sin to have them below your ankle, even if you're not doing it out of pride or arrogance. And we're going to deal with that, inshallah, the same way we dealt with this issue, bi'idhnillah, with fuller details from all of the angles. Concerning trimming the hair off your cheek, obviously, we're speaking from the position that it is not permissible to shave your beard, to touch your beard. You can't trim it up or anything. You have to leave it the way it is. Unless you're making Hajj or Umrah, then you can make the qabda. Take from the fistful, whatever exceeds beyond the fist, cut it off. So what about the person who's of that opinion that you shouldn't take your beard, touch anything about your beard? What about the hair that grows on your cheek? We go back to the language of the Arabs to identify for us what is the beard. What is the beard? So there are some people who are quite hairy. They have hair from their chest up their neck and it comes into their beard. Do they keep that hair on their neck? No, that's not your beard. The hair of the beard to the Arabs is the hair that comes right here from the ear, from the temple, right here, and it goes down the cheekbone all the way to the cheek, to the chin. That's the lihya. The hair under your eyes and all of this is not your lihya according to the language of the Arabs. Al-Imam Ibn Abi Shayb in his book, Kitab al-Musannaf, he brings us narrations in which the people used to allow the people to shave that thing off and shave this from under the neck. So the lihya is what comes down the two cheeks, the cheekbone, the jawbone, that's what it is. The jawbone, and it goes to the chin. As for up here, under here, your neck, that is not the lihya. Any more questions, Ikhwani? Because I can barely see, I can't see. إذن نكتفي بهذا القدر ونسأل الله تعالى يوفقنا وإياكم ويثبتنا على الكتاب والسنة وعلى طريقة السلف هذا وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك وأشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك
غرباء 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 Oh,